Well, before we begin today, I just want to say how thankful and how glad I am to be here presenting to you guys. As a student and as a family member with friends and family, I've always loved looking at TEDx, watching the videos, and being inspired. So to be a part of such a great event, I'm just really happy to be here today presenting for you guys. So let's begin. I'm going to be telling a story today, and it's kind of different, but it's my story, so I'm really glad that I can share it with you guys. So it all started in Corning, New York, where I grew up. As a little child, I really enjoyed going on sleepovers, hanging out with my friends. The sleepover was the best way that my friends and I could connect and hang out, and it was just great because it's a night of fun where you get to hang out, and right when you go to sleep and you wake up, it's like you get to pick it up over and over again. So the one thing that always got to me was, as I was falling asleep, as the lights were going off, I would grow scared to make these noises that I couldn't control, and scared to keep my friends awake, even though I knew they understood what I was going through. So that's my segue into what I'm going to be talking to you guys today about, which is my journey with Tourette's syndrome. So Tourette's syndrome is a neurological disorder that occurs when people experience these tics, both motor and vocal. So motor tics are when people make these noises that they can't control, sometimes shouting or grunting or coughing. Whereas vocal tics, on the other hand, they're more phrases or sounds that similarly a person cannot control. And sometimes these phrases even manifest in the form like words they don't intend to say, such as swear words, which is known as coprolalia. And all these things, people do them involuntarily. They're not trying to make these sounds. And sometimes people react to them differently. Sometimes people are offended, but they just don't know what's going on. So I'm going to share more about that today. So one question still remains. What is Tourette's syndrome, and what causes it? The true cause really isn't known to individuals or neurologists. They do concede that it is hereditary, and sometimes you can inherit it from a family member or your brothers or your sister. No one really knows. But all I know is that there must be someone in my family who had it, but I'm stuck with it now, so it's good for me to just talk about it to you guys. So where does this story begin to me, with me? It began in Corning, New York, as I said, and I was just a little child on my Christmas break trying to enjoy myself when one day it happened. I started making these high-pitched noises that I couldn't control, and my family members were like, "Why are you making these sounds? Are you just playing around?" And I really just didn't know at that point. I thought that I was weird and that I couldn't control it, but I didn't know how to express what it really was. So later when I would go to school, my teachers, staff, they would say things like, "Stop making those sounds. You sound like an animal. Why are you doing these things?" And when you couple the fact that I didn't know why and I didn't know how, it was hard for me to answer, and it just led to really awkward situations. For example, when a teacher was reading a story or when we were taking a test, I would make these sounds and I would make these movements, distracting my classmates. And I didn't mean to do these things, but the result was the same. And what I could have done was been more open about it, but I wouldn't really grow that courage until later on. So flash forward until fifth grade, where I've moved back to Taiwan, and I encountered a whole new community. And Taipei American School people were very kind and accepting about it. My teachers knew about it. And I think that's just a testament to our school. It's great how someone like me didn't really face any serious incidents, and I'm really grateful for that. So now I'm going to share some anecdotes that have occurred to me throughout my experience at this school. So in sixth grade, I was learning in band class, and I had started playing the alto saxophone back in the United States. And my friend was playing French horn next to me, and we had grown to be pretty close friends. I would see him every day in class. And the one thing I remember was this. I developed this urge where I would do this thing where I would flex my middle finger while keeping all the other fingers down. And this is, you can imagine, this is a really inconvenient thing to do. It's not great. I was his close friend, and he'd say things like, "Why are you doing this? Am I that bad of a player? Come on, dude. Offer me some constructive criticism. Don't just do this to me." And I said, "I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do this." But in the end, I was more open about it, and I explained it, and he understood. So before I move on to some more anecdotes, I want to quantify what this urge to do these actions or to make these sounds really feels like. So imagine this, you're in a hurry to go to school and you've forgotten an important assignment due to your teacher. And all throughout that day, you're going through your life, you get home to lunch, you're going to other classes, but you can't focus because you're just thinking about the stress that you'll experience when you have to admit and own up to this teacher. So it's harder to take other tests, to talk to friends, to just have fun. And when you do reach that class, when you finally own up to your teacher, they understand. And you just feel this sigh of relief that comes out of you. And that's how living with Tourette's feels like. So if someone has a Tourette's, like they have to blink or they have to express a certain sound, they're gonna feel this strong urge to do it until it just comes out. And holding it back is only delaying the inevitable. For me though, my tics range mostly on the mild side, so I can control them when I had to and even hide them, but I found the best approach now is to just be more open about it, and that's why I decided to do something like this in TEDx. So moving back to the anecdotes that I was talking to you about, in seventh grade, I did my first foray into this event called Model United Nations, where you embody a country and its stance, and you approach a debate with that stance in mind. And originally I was planning to do the tryout for rugby, and my friend Sean Reed at the time, he just looked at me and said one word, one phrase, "You're gonna hurt yourself if you do rugby, you're too short, just try out for the Shanghai MUN team." And I thought, you know, he's right. I was inspired by my brother who was older and did IASIS rugby, but maybe that inspiration would have to wait until another time for me. And so I went to the tryout, and needless to say, I did get in after a 2-minute speech and writing an essay, and I was really surprised. So I thanked that friend. And as I got in, as we went through this MUN process, one of the things involved an opening speech. So this would be your first impression that you give at the conference when you share your stance and who you are as a delegate. So I was working with this upper school mentor called Ryan Sun, who's still my good friend today. I was looking at him, he was looking at me, giving me this good advice, and he said, "Why are you making this certain facial expression?" Now, this was one of my more embarrassing tics where, you know, that same urge I just described to you, it was happening in my face, so things like blinking, but at that stage, it really was this thing that compelled me to scrunch up my face. So what it really looked like was like I was kissing the audience, or making this really strange kissing face to the audience. Which, as you know, in Model United Nations speaking is not the most ideal thing to do. So I just explained to him what it was, and I felt like a load was lifted off my chest. And I realized at that moment that it's better to be open about a problem. So not only can we receive help, but just people will judge us differently through a different lens. The other funny thing about this tip for me was, say if you're talking to a girl you like, or you're talking to a teacher or something like that, and you start making this kissing face to them, you can imagine how embarrassing and how unfortunate it is. So it's also exacerbated by the fact that when you're nervous, it gets worse. So if I was talking to a cute girl, or I was talking to a teacher or something funny like that, it would just get worse and I'd feel a little more awkward about it. So I think the best policy for me was to just be more open about it and just to share what I was feeling about it. So flash forward now to eighth grade, and I started going through eighth grade, doing these different clubs, and one club I enjoyed was the 3D design club because the art department had some 3D printers. So we were mixed in with some sixth graders, eighth graders, and my friend Shari and I, you might have heard of him before he moved away, we were sitting at this table, and I was doing this tick where I was blinking, and it looked like I was rolling my eyes in an offensive way. And some sixth graders look at me and they say, "Why do you keep rolling your eyes at us? You know, that's not really respectful. Like, can you just stop doing that?" And I said, "I'm sorry, I won't do it again," because I was still kind of shy at this point. But my friend, he stands up for me and he said, "You know, he has Tourette syndrome, he can't control it, and he's not trying to be offensive or rude." And after he said that, those people, they understood and they were really kind about it. And that moment for me, it was opening my eyes to the fact that if you're more honest about a situation or not afraid to speak up for something you might consider a shortcoming for yourself, it may actually lead to better understanding between people. And in fact, cases where people are really kind and open about it, which I really appreciated. So these are just some little anecdotes that have occurred to me at Taipei American School. Now I'm going to share some more humorous and inconvenient ones. So the daily ones would be things like playing video games. So if I was playing a car racing game, and I was racing my brother or my friends, I look at the controls and I keep blinking or craning my neck, and then my car would crash and I'd always lose the race. And my brother's like, wow, you should not be driving a car in this game or real life for that matter. And I said, okay. Yeah, so that's another challenge. I'm not sure how I'm gonna drive a car when I grow up, but I do know that when I'm doing things like ping pong or cross country, it goes away a little bit. So maybe when you're more focused, people with Tourette's syndrome experience a lesser degree of their Tourette's. And also things like a soccer game or a basketball game. I remember I was watching this basketball game and our team was down by a few points and someone scored an important basket. And I was like, wait, what just happened? I was blinking. I didn't see the goal. Could someone please explain? They said, yeah, we just went up in the game and we're ahead now. And I said, oh, well, good job. And lastly, there are just moments where I just feel tired doing it. For example, I would just be walking with friends trying to eat dinner and I'd just keep making these expressions and I couldn't control them. And it would just be tired. That's one of the words I would use to explain it. So one thing I turned to was sports, because my doctor told me, you know, if you're so tired, you literally won't have the energy or the will to do ticks, so it could actually decrease if you start doing a lot of sports. So I encourage you to do sports. So that's when I tried out for the cross country team last year. And I encountered my own problems with this. So sometimes I'd be running in a race and I'd have to do a vocalization tick, and it would take away from like me just breathing and trying to focus on running. And other times it would be hard for me to run in a straight line because I'd be blinking and I couldn't really control like my movement. So there are aspects like that that just made life a little more difficult. And I also had some teammates who would on occasion mock me, but I really feel like it was just in jest, and in the end I made up with them and they're still my friends today. So in conclusion, how do you guys think that you can relate to this? Sure, you may not be this guy who flips people off or blows kisses or does all these weird things that the Tourette's compels me to do. You may not be anything like that. But what you do share in common with me, what we all share in common, is the difficulties that we go through in life. Whether it's the college admissions process, becoming a better dancer, doing well in sports, doing well in that test, you always have a moment where you just want to step back and think, I don't think I can do this, or I don't think I can succeed. So what I challenge you to do is focus on the journey, because it's your journey. Focus on why you love doing these things. I mean, back off on the test example. I'm not sure any of us enjoy taking tests or taking stressful tests, but something as difficult as becoming a better public speaker, getting into college, doing dance, doing sports, think about why you do them. You do them because you enjoy them. When you focus on why you love something, why you're doing it, for me, cross country, because I love the teammates. For me, jazz, because I love the instrument. For me, playing Minecraft because I love video games, even though it may be hard for me to fumble with the controls sometimes. I focus on why I love doing them, because when you focus on what's getting you into something, you are reminded, hey, I love doing this, and it may be hard sometimes, but I'm doing this because I want to be doing it. So in conclusion, look at your story, look at your title here, and think, what would you title your story? And when you go about this story, think, it may be difficult, it may be hard, it may be challenging, but just remember, I'm doing this test, or I'm doing this activity, I'm doing MUN, whatever it is, I'm doing it because I want to be able to do it, and I love doing it, and it's my passion. So focus on the passions, and don't focus on the difficulty of the journey, and you'll rediscover why you love doing all these things, and you'll apply yourself to them better. So thank you for your time today, and hope you have a great day.